stay in that race for MSI and the Cup. And we have a pro player and a coach here. What does OG have to do at this point in time to pull it back in?
Well, if I was Nico the Pickle, I would ban LeBlanc and I would ban Zed. And then I would leave the Ryze open because it's not like a playmaking champion which Perk is going to kill your whole team with. And he's not going to snowball lane either because it's not like Zed and LeBlanc. You cannot just dash over, like around and kill everyone. So I think if they play the exact same draft and then the enemy has Ryze, then you just kite backwards and then you just play slow the early game. And then your composition is so much stronger scaling. And I think they should really ban out the Assassin champions from Perks because he's just snowballing out of control. And yeah, it's
apt analysis.
We actually have some of those plays from Perks, really reminiscent of game one on LeBlanc. Honestly, if you're not able to contain him, he will absolutely take over the game.
And we saw Power in some rough situations, not having the exhaust into the Zed at times when Zed's just going to come straight at you under that tower. And what do you do against this at this point? There's not really a lot that can be done here, but you know, it was a tough matchup for Power of Evil.
And there is something they can do. Origin have decided to swap in Xpeke. Power of Evil is out for game four, and Xpeke is in. And this is the same thing that Origin did when they were down match point versus H2K. You guys said that it didn't influence you guys that much, or it wouldn't influence you guys that much in that series. But how much of a mental switch is it for both teams?
Well, for OG, it's going to be kind of like a nice little reset button because it's going to be kind of like the new flavors back.
Lulu?
Yeah, I mean, it's going to be slightly new picks. There's like the threat of cheese, and there's also like, you know, this guy's been watching all the games, so he's gotten to experience how G2's been playing and like the flaws of OG, so we can really follow up on what their mistakes are and what they should be improving on because he's been watching.
Now, Febben, how much of a difference do you think it will make? Well, can Xpeke take over a game like Perks can? Possibly not.
I don't think Xpeke is as good as Perks with Zed and LeBlanc, obviously, but he knows well how to not die with Azir against Zed, for example. Even though last game was a bit unlucky for the Azir because he had to exhaust him at level 3 and then after that he just died. But I think Xpeke is going to do better, probably.
I think he'll do pretty well. The problem was the time we saw him against H2K, he actually tweeted after the game, yeah, thanks guys for carrying me. I'm back out of this. Power of Evil take my energy. He just played the Lulu, as he said. But I think there's actually one other key thing here that, looking forward now, Origin, if they're going to win, have to go to game 5. And if they do sub Power of Evil back into the game, like they did against H2K, Power's now had a game sat by his coach, talking about the game, looking from an outside perspective. So that's actually a unique dynamic that we don't see very often, being able to, you know, take a step back mid-series as an active player. So I'm interested to see whether that plays into things.
I mean, I think it could be good in terms of, like, yeah, getting PoE, like, yeah, kind of, like, back in it. But I still think for purple side, Peke will just be better because PoE has all these, like, really nice, solid blind pick mids, and Peke has all these, like, cheesy champs that he can pick all the time. And for PoE, like, his cheese is like Syndra or like Cassio. It's like okay, but it's playable, you know?
We'll see what happens. Something we touched on before the series, or a couple of things. First off, Ebevin, you had a lot of praise for the bottom lane for OG, saying that they would be able to snowball it in the favor, but Sven, just to give one example, is 5-15 over 3 games. He has not had a time to shine, maybe, or do you think they should have forced more? What do you think happened?
I think Sven is in Elo hell right now. I don't know. Like, I think the first game he played pretty good. The second game they played against Twisted Fate. Or was it the third game?
Second game, Twisted Fate.
Second game, Twisted Fate. And the Twisted Fate just focused bottom a lot. And then the third game, yeah, I don't know. It was just over after 5 minutes. And it's not much he can do, to be honest.
That was quite painful. Another thing we touched on was the macro game, or lack thereof, or macro game in development from the side of G2.
Say the word some more.
Macro.
Okay, so I will give G2 their tier 1 turret macro is okay. They know the best play to get out of the tier 1 turrets and stuff like that. Once we get to like tier 2s and in the base, you know, we even saw in game 1 where they went to dive like top and hib, when they could just like run the Baron and stuff. That's when like the macro play kind of like gets a lot more important. But earlier in the game, they're good at dives. They like know how to set up dives, how to get the wards out, how to push the lanes, build the waves, and abuse the waves. But as the game goes on, I think they just forget to look at their mini map and just like want to kill everything in their like, immediate vicinity.
Which is interesting for us.
It does make the game a lot more interesting. Maybe not pretty, but very exciting. Yes. This isn't exactly the pinnacle of, you know, tower pushing and lane swaps, that kind of thing that we're seeing in
a finals. I think it's a welcome refreshment.
I would agree with you, especially in an arena full of fans making a lot of noise with all the kills. I think it makes for an entertaining series. I do agree with you with the way that G2 look for a lot of fights. Sometimes they're good fights, sometimes they're horrible fights, and sometimes they manage to steal a Baron when they really shouldn't after losing a fight. So, you know, some of it is G2 setting it up, some of it is kind of OG walking in towards them in these kind of situations, but certainly it makes for a fun series.
Well, it does seem to be the circumstances of a final. If we think back to Fnatic versus OG in the summer split finals, if we think back to UOL versus Fnatic, in spring, it went all the way to 5 games, and it came down to those individual mistakes in the course of it. If they both nail the pick and ban, who is crisper in the team fights, and who is most likely to make those mistakes, Febivan?
It's really hard to tell because XPK is playing now, and it's a lot different because it really depends on as well how to adapt in the next draft. If they ban the assassins, then I think they will have a way easier time, and they can just play their composition out and scale up, and then win by team fighting. But if Gamers2 gets some kills early game again, then they're just going to snowball again, like we saw.
Yeah, I mean, OG's comps and all of these are legitimate comps. Like, they have, like, strengths and weaknesses, and they have, like, obvious goals. G2 has a couple of comps that are just like, go get them, boys. So I think if OG is able to, like, control, like, perks in the mid lane and, like, you know, not overextend to give trick-free kills, I think they play up to 15 minutes even, and I think they actually have like a really solid way to close the game out.
We will see what happens with XPK back in the lineup for OG. It is time to load up on picks and bans, so let's kick it over to our casters.
Thank you very much, Shox. We are indeed ready to go for what could be the final game of the spring split. Yeah, it's okay, DeFicio. Thank you for trying. I know your heart's in the right place.
I was trying to help.
It's also okay. Been telling me for the longest time to get on a box, but I just refuse to stand on the box.
We're just going
to
do.
Arata looks short, so let's just establish that, get the joke out of the way, and get to some League of Legends analysis.
Well, we're going to dial right into this one, too, because with Peke back, it changes a little bit, as Febin was talking about also on the desk. I do want to get your guys' pulse on the whole situation, because
Paulson's not here.
Well, he's around, I'm sure. Your thoughts?
Fire is so thrown off right now.
Yeah, I think it's good to change up the pace of the game. I think unless PoE had another champion ready, somehow sounds like Isandra or something, I think it's a good change to put XPK in.
I mean, maybe that's the pick they're looking for, and that's why they swap him in. Febivan talked a lot about taking away the assassins, the counter picks from perks. Definitely have to agree with him, like Zed LeBlanc. Two big picks, but again, I feel there are ways you can draft where the blind pick Zed is not as scary. And then the question is, like, do you want to leave Ryze open against perks? Do you want to maybe give it to XPK?
It's a scary thought.
In an earlier rotation?
The answer is no.
Is no. So either now you leave Nidalee open, which is also no, then you give an assassin over.
Any other questions?
I mean, you can still ban the last assassin, which is the LeBlanc, and then again, pick a mid laner who does well into Zed. And we get one of the things we were looking at in the last game. Like, what happens when you don't early pick that jungler for macing and take the Sivir with the 280 carry bans? Trick now gets one of his favorite jungle picks where he can be even more aggressive in the early game.
It is straight up his style. That's exactly what he wants to play. It's kind of a more aggressive early game dueling Graves.
Yeah, and I think we might see Elise coming in as an answer from Amazing with Skirmisher Saber into the Kindred and say try and match some of the early game power. Give a bit more ganking presence as well.
I love the Elise Braum here, because Braum is actually a fantastic pick into, in my opinion, Kindred overall, because you could shut down a lot of her damage in teamfights and still like annoy people with those concussive blows in the ulted. And now you can play a 1-3-1 Sivir comp with double TP with a Lissandra if you want on the next rotation.
Yeah, you can go Lissandra Maokai as your next rotation. That's a very, very good composition for team fighting and more power in the early game as well.
Well, they do manage to lock that one in. The Braum goes over to Mythi and Amazing with his comfortable pick. I mean, there's a reason we call him the Amazing Spider-Man sometimes.
Do we?
That's my name for him.
Oh.
Back when he was on TSM, that's what I used to say.
This is the other option. When you play Pekka, Lulu is there.
Yeah.
It's his
obviously.
Pick.
Obviously, back to the world.
Yeah. But if you do pick Lulu, I feel like we might just see Twisted Fate as an answer to it. Mythi making a bit of fun of his mid laner, who was not known as the greatest Azir player in the history of League of Legends.
That was a tough matchup for him.
He's plenty of time to practice. Let's talk a little bit about that Janna Caitlyn, though. I think it's a very good answer into Sivir. It's rough if Braum gets to block too many abilities, but it's just an incredibly strong Whittle down lane, and it outrages any advantage you can get from the minor Braum poke too. So it just, it destroys Braum Sivir. That's a TLDR of that. Yeah.
So OG knows they want a lane swap.
They need a lane swap.
Straight away with this one. Another reason, actually, if this Lulu gets logged in, I think Twisted Fate is a fantastic answer against it.
Oh.
There it is.
What you guys were looking for. Final seconds tick down. And we get the Lissandra lock in. And a Gragas, too.
And a Gragas now can shift to top as a pick. And it's actually good to Kindred because it can mess up that Lamb's Respite and just really throw people off guard and maybe get a kill.
I think Maokai is a much stronger top lane pick, though. Compared to Gragas, Gragas has some good things, like first of all, you max W and you get good damage against some of these tanks in the small duels. But Echo is a great, we call him a tank killer as well. Like in the 1v1, he can outduel most other tanks. We get the Lissandra we talked about.
I feel like Echo is that rendition of that April Fool's Lee Sin spotlight they one time brought out, like a hybrid mobile melee assassin tank.
Does a bit of everything.
Yeah, of course, I think we'll get to it.
So this is a matchup a lot of EU mid laners are not 100% confident taking the Zed into. Lissandra, but I think Perks at this point is saying, first of all, Assassins, it's our style, it's how we want to play. And also against Pekka, Pekka is a weaker laner than Power of Evil. I think Perks is saying, you know what, I can take this matchup and I can win it.
Yeah, but one of Pekka's, like, he kind of uses that weak lane reputation against him to make people kind of go over, you're going to try and kill him. And then his team comes in for the 3v1.
Outsmart you.
For the 3v1 cheese ganks. You know, Pepperman, I think, shared the same fate in the European LCS. The last time Fnatic and OG faced up against each other.
All right, guys. Well, it is all on the line here. G2 find themselves at match point, and Origin are one game away from getting knocked off by the newcomers. If you think they can do it and bring it back to game number 5, hashtag OG win is your call. G2 win, of course, being on the other side of the thing. They're all looking for that trophy, that spot at MSI, the prestige, the glory. We will have a new champion here in Europe, but who's it going to be? Are we going to find out this game? We'll have to see. Let's leave it on the Rift.
And I definitely like some of the changes for Origin, some of them. With the Lissandra pick coming in, giving him more early game punch. Get Sivir as well for Sven, so you don't put him on an Ezreal, slow scaling. At least to match some early game power of Kindred. And we are still in that situation where they are looking to scale up a bit because it's so much physical damage once more for G2 and NZ, who runs out of targets late game.
Oh, I like this. So when Origin won the lane swap, they commit to invading deep on the top side and then just taking that lane over with a potential level 3 gank from Amazing if they get called on their bluff. But look at where Emperor and Hybrid are hiding right now. This is what I want to see teams do more. It's risky because it leaves you with less active members on the map, but you just hide your dual lane in the top lane. And unless OG go for the blind reswap bot, G2 find their favorable lane matchups.
It basically means you don't get any wards in the enemy jungle. When they invade in, normally you would just trade wards. And you would see if they went back to their own jungle and moved down to the bottom lane with the Sivir, with the Braum, and you would know, okay, they're on bottom side. You lose out on that. But they're really expecting expecting Origin to go top lane after not spotting anyone, and then Janna, Caitlyn awaits.
Yeah, I almost feel like you should drop a random ward in your jungle when you do that. And now Hybrid's gonna check in. This is dangerous though, walking into Mithy.
Oh, now they know.
Oh, Mithy sadly revealed himself here. So Hybrid, good timing here. Another zone. Oh, this is big. I feel like Emperor and Hybrid can drop a little bit of poke here, but they're really respecting the backup that can come in from Amazing at any time. So that's why they really don't want to drop low and just play the wave on wave to zone.
And they should have learned now from a last game where Amazing took the red buff, did Raptors, did Crooks, and then went for an early gank on top lane. Now they know he's behind them, and they have to be a little bit more careful. Afraid of that or respected.
That's why they let it themselves be pushed in, because in no universe does Janna, Caitlyn want to be pushed in. They want to be the lane that pushes in constantly, but they're afraid of that level 3 Amazing gank. So, in essence, Origin have a backup plan if the lanes get called with that Amazing hovering on the top side. SOAS will pay the price for that with less pressure in the bottom lane, though.
This is a very interesting mid lane matchup now. Zed does well to take the first few levels in, but Lissandra will just push and push and push and nothing else. Like, and then you get into that kind of good situation for Lissandra where you can go for an early Hourglass, which you like anyway, but it's not ideal when it comes to your damage. Like, ideally you want like Abyssal into, say, Morel Normicon, and you're extremely strong, full cooldown reduction, a lot of damage. That will get delayed a lot. Abyssal is not really an option into Zed.
Mithis stepping on these traps on purpose. Early traps here for Emperor, so no 90 caliber net available just yet.
Well, that could be big too, as Amazing has been hanging out towards this top side. If G2 step a little too far forward, they might find themselves with a spider at their backs. Perks, a little bit more damage there, the Thunderlord's proc.
And again, we talk about Lissandra just trying to push lane.
He's got mid. Oh, yeah, that's a quick flash.
Burks uses his shadow to arrest Xpeke here, who's sidestepping a lot of the abilities. And then Amazing just walks in and kind of punishes that.
And now again, with Lissandra running teleport, when you have these early traits, if you force the potions off the enemy mid laner, it is so much better for you, because you can then push out recall and just quickly return to lane with your first teleport, and he has to then recall and slowly walk back, and he falls even further behind in farm and experience. You're probably not going to see Xpeke try and kill the Z1v1, because more will be the first item for perks of getting that early MR and shield. But again, it's about Origin playing the 1v1, matching it, and then setting up these team fights more than trying to one-on-one a Zed. That's not the goal with this composition from Origin.
Definitely not. Things staying relatively quiet, and even compared to the bloodbaths that we've had in games 1 through 3. G2 just want to keep these lanes on a going. Mythi and Sven have had a little bit of a hard time, but they do manage to have themselves or pick themselves a farm advantage for the time being. It really does trade back and forth though by minutes.
Actually surprised Emperor is really using his Q at all in this lane. Generally when you see Caitlyn Janna's face off against Sivir, the only way you poke Sivir is if you get her spell shield on cooldown and then you poke her again. But the amount of mana you return to her, you kind of get traded on again. So it's generally a better option to just not use any spells on her whatsoever and let her go out of mana. That's why these random cupcakes on the lane are just giving Sven so much free mana overall.
I think we just saw G2's bot lane try and play a lot safer in the start and saying we can just go aggressive after the first back. We get to see Xpeke keeping back to lane as we mentioned earlier. Perks had a good recall himself, got triple longsword. Extra potion, didn't really lose a whole lot from this.
Nope.
And now it's about, do you get level 6 first on the Zed, then you can all in, but once there's 6 on Lissandra, you can't really do anything. I'm just trying to poke her off the tower. And then you always have to respect enemy jungle showing up, because Lissandra stun into a cocoon from Elise, Zed dies.
Perks will definitely be well acquainted with that one. Of course, it may not slow down the bloodlust he has been exhibiting this whole series on all those assassins. Mythi stepping up forward,
down to push deep,
back.
Mythi.
Emperor, he does take a lot of damage after the Unbreakable has popped, but the Zephyr on him a lot more. And Emperor exhausted, they need one more. And Trick comes out of nowhere, but Mythi with a quick flash away.
Heal used by Sven, flash used by Mythi.
I mean, face a flash on the jungler. Mythi's really good at holding his flash until the absolutely latest moment necessary.
We see the play around mid lane. 6 now for Pekka, he's going in.
It's a bitsy spider, and Perks is going to creep himself away. Peke with the serious farm advantage as well, with a lot of help from Amazing patrolling in that mid lane. Perks has really not had a whole lot to be able to do.
Again, it's just about Lissandra constantly pushing it up and having that threat of an enemy jungler showing up with Lissandra's own CC to get that one kill. Emperor right now.
There's the net.
But we have to credit Origin. Okay. They've outplayed G2's bot lane here 2v2. In a matchup that they should lose, whittle down poke, whether it's due to Emperor making some mistakes in skill usage, or Mythi just really understanding that he has to walk forward. So often we'll see Mythi walk forward almost like recklessly to get those procs off just for zone. We'll get to back later
another
here.
Gank mid.
Another gank mid.
Amazing is right back, and there's the Frozen Tomb. Teleport coming in, but it may be too late. Amazing! No, that's going to be Perks going in, but Perks going down for first blood, and Peke staying alive. Kick is too late to the party. Tries to take a swing, but he misses at Amazing.
And I'm so happy to see Origin continue trying to gank this mid lane. We hype it up a little bit, how you can shut down the Zed with double CC between Lissandra and the Elise, and they try it again and again and again. No flash from Perks. Great setup here. Peke even managed to clear out the last caster minion that was blocking the cocoon with his Q.
He's very afraid that Amazing would try and like curve the cocoon around the minions, but he good patience there. And yeah, the synergy between Peke and Amazing coming back, because this is something we don't usually see when Amazing goes for ganks for Power of Evil.
Definitely. Not something we see often, but Amazing likes to camp for Peke instead.
Yeah.
Also,
he knows he'll get a raise.
Of course. Origin always talks about how Peke is very vocal as well in the lane. He will tell you, okay, we can keep ganking this, we can eventually get that stun onto him with my ulti, and then you can follow up. And they're confident in the calls coming from Peke, and very, very good start. And one of the reasons we like this Lissandra being picked blind by Peke, so the Zed becomes a lot riskier to play from Perks.
It's a visible change, and G2 just do not seem up to the same standard so far. It is still very early to tell.
8 minutes in, Pyro.
I'm going to make a bold claim, I know.
A tough man to play.
But this Lissandra has come up absolutely massive so far. It has had a lot of help from amazing perks, however. He's but going on a roll.
Yeah. When you play an Azir into the Zed will try and just shadow out of your Azir ulti. You can't do that against the Sun.
See the evolving. I'll be taking Van here now. Trick coming in to look for Sven. That's a quick flash away as the teleport comes in from Soaz. Throws the big barrel, knocks Trick back into this one. Lam's Respite is forced. And now Origin are going to back away. They can't keep fighting this one. Soaz now having to burn his own flash, and Mithy standing behind, or rather standing in front. And Perks is caught out by Peke. Get off my lawn.
Yeah, he was trying to run up the top lane to join the fight. Then suddenly realizing Elise and Lissandra were behind him, and then no way out for Perks. Another flash being used. Died twice already. Why not just gank that mid lane one more time?
Amazing, looking to make more impact here.
He's got no mana. Kickus, meanwhile, is free pushing on this bottom side. There's no reaction available.
Yeah, he needs to get something back here because the top side of the map is being lost. Power of Evil, wherever that is, weighs in with some opinion. They did win the draft.
It's good.
Yeah.
He's able to take a back seat for this game and swatch out all in.
All jokes aside, I think it's fantastic that the synergy and kind of the approach OG have had towards the season with Power of Evil and Xpeke. See a dive though, so we'll get back to that later.
Yep, G2, three of them caught in the middle, and instantly Trick just getting blown up. They take themselves another as well. Double kill over to Amazing. They grab everything and they get out.
It's just fantastic use of this Lissandra Elise combo. Everything starts in the mid lane. Once you start winning the mid lane, you can roam to other lanes, take your advantage, give it to the bot lane, give it to the top laner. This case is just Perks being caught up, but again, Zed is not running a global. Lissandra will run the global, so once you've shut him down in lane, use that global to snowball other lanes. It's just a great setup by Origin, pushing in, and it's one of those plays where G2 are probably calling already, it's going to happen.
Yeah.
That's why Trick is already on the tower, but there's no response.
And ironically, that used to be G2 style. They give you a place and they tell you, well, this is exactly what's going to happen. Either you defend this tower and you die doing so, or you give it up to us and we'll take it anyways. And
like right here, already called by both teams.
But the mistake
is going to happen.
Everybody knows that this is going to play out. Maybe one kill could be traded, but just a really good opening. Amazing gets a turret aggro. This is the only thing you need to guarantee when you're diving and you have an Elise on your team. Let Elise go first. Reset the aggro. That means three free shots that you can take. And a very clean dive. And honestly, Amazing and Xpeke as a team have been doing well. But it also just, you have to give credit to Sven and Miffy playing, in my opinion, a rough matchup and beating it. Sivir Braum should not be able to go even CS against Janna and Caitlyn, because then the value from those pick is completely undermined.
I'm still looking at this Zed into Lissandra. I think it's Perk saying he's confident playing the lane and he can outplay Pekka, but it's not just Pekka you're playing against, it's also Amazing.
Yeah, the scores tell a different story, and Perks has to living shadow to relative safety. But look, Amazing's already here yet again. And the CS starts to tell that story too. Kickus is the only one who's really been having a better time with it, but that's because Soaz has been getting involved in the teleporting and moving around the map a little bit more to take out that tower in the bottom side. But that's all G2 have really been able to answer for in this one. 1,000 and some change is the lead for Origin at 11 and a half minutes.
And a Caitlyn who loses lane will have
not a good
15 minutes of being completely useless until 2 or 3 items are completed and you have some impact, but then you need like 4 items to become a big carry.
Yeah, you need somebody to walk in your traps then too.
So, you need so much time now as a Caitlyn. Oh, Soaz.
Yeah, he does have the Chrono Breaker and he uses it. Hybrid and Mithy knocking each other up, but Hybrid does not have the stats to keep alive in this one. He's gonna have to burn his flash and his ultimate, but Emperor does find an opening here. Sven
he's
very low. In comes Kickus around the backside. Time Winder moves it, lines it up, not even needed with the ace in the hole, and Kickus goes hunting. Reset on the ace, they get Mithy, more damage, Time Winder unbreakable, or is it? He's gonna go down. That's a double kill for the top laner of G2.
Honestly, Kickus has been playing very well this game. Dodge of the ulti from Perks.
Oh, trying to stay alive, and this one Amazing. He's ignited Perks, and the spider goes up, the spider goes down. Perks turns around, but Peke puts him in a tomb.
And that's the thing, right? You can't dodge the ulti at first, but where are you going to go? There's no flash if you're Perks, because you used it twice and still got ganked right after. And the 2v2 is great for Origin in the mid lane with Amazing and Peke. But that was a great response.
I mean, what,
2v2? From G2.
It's a 2v1.
Oh, sorry, the 2v1. Yeah, that was unfair. Perks is alone here.
We've been seeing Trick in all these previous games, especially in the standard lanes, just kind of camp it out for Perks, but it's just tables have turned in this one. Let's see how this 2v2, though, happens up top.
Great play by Hybrid here. understanding that...
I mean, he almost dies, though. Luckily, yeah, he has dust available.
I just like the fact that he doesn't flash instantly. He actually buys more time for his AD carry, then flashes when he knows the stun is landing. And Kickers, who just had a fight in bot lane.
Yeah, Kickers played this really well. Just small things of where he positions his Q and makes sure he takes out the escape path so that he still has flash available to now chase Mythi. And yeah, Janna lanes are generally just letting your AD carry 1v2 as best as he can and being a nuisance. Hybrid did that well. Perks here, remarkable effort, but look at Pekka, he's just hovering. He's constantly clicking R, ready on perks, just waiting by the ghost, and both of them were very calm and collected in that dive.
Yeah. So much for weak laning phase. He does have a lot of help, but 4-0-2 is a very respectable score on the board. Now Kickus and Soaz want to bop at each other, but amazing. He's just all over the map this game, and he looks for a hunting trip. Dodging out of the cocoon with the chrono break is Kickus, and there is Pekka teleporting in the backside. Kickus knows he might be in a spot of trouble right now and keeps trying to stay alive. Barrels are flying. Kickus throws the convergence down, but it might be a little too late as the cocoon catches him. And amazing, claims another.
He's dancing around a lot, Kickus. Luckily for him, he didn't give another assist over to Pekka. So went down in the end, and now Lissandra is back towards the mid lane. There's still TP for Soaz. Mythi's roaming down as well to try and stop
teleport on
tower from dying.
This is Soaz, he's gonna burn this one to come back in. No, he cancels at the last
the
moment.
Bait. He just wanted them off tower.
They moved him off.
Successful roam from Mythi as well, forcing them off and
false alarm. And now they got a dance on. Good dodge, skills. Hybrid rejoins Emperor back up top, throws the shield on him. And they continue this 2v2 that really didn't go how we expected. 20 CS.
Yeah, and if you're wondering where that tier 1 for Origin or for G2 went down, it went down during one of the replays. That's one tower up here. Mm-hmm. Now they can actually push in that Zed even farther. Yeah, set up for the rotations. One of those rotations could be a dive on the bottom lane.
Yeah, he might have walked himself into a trap. He gets hit up by the body slam. Frozen Tomb's on, and he doesn't stand a chance as Soaz claims him. And Trick comes in to try and defend way too late.
Man, G2 has zero respect for Pekka and the way he's roaming around the map. First, the dive on top lane, where he got 3 kills for his team. Kickus then walks bot lane, uses everything to get back into the minion wave, and has no backup ready.
And this is a team that has done this exact strategy so often with double TP lanes and 1-3-1 composition, so they know the play pattern that is push up mid and roam bot and dive. And they just seem to be not respecting the counterplay, or they're just flustered. They did not expect the game to kind of play out the way it did.
Definitely getting surprised on this one. G2 with the blind aggression are getting over and over, thoroughly punished here, as 3,000 is the gold lead for Origin, who look to stay alive and force the game at number 5. Let's see if they can do it. G2 to push on the top side. Sven clearing the wave out with the boomerang blade, and Emperor's got to back away. Meanwhile, Dragon started for Origin.
And it's just very, very good use, again, of a winning mid lane matchup. That's why if you play side lane, so much is about your mid lane still. Like if he's having the pressure in mid and he can roam first, you can start pushing up the towers. You know he can join in. You know he can set up tower dives. If your mid laner is behind, on the other hand, he relies on either one crazy teleport play or just like constantly calling where the enemy mid laner is going, and you have to play really passive.
Much higher impact from Amazing 2 overall this game on this release. Whether it's the champion or being back with Xpeke and having kind of like two voices direct the jungle pathing, regardless of why it happened, he's just been involved in nearly every gank so far, just as Xpeke has. There's only been that one kill where he did not get the assist. Massive pressure here from
the Herald fight.
Origin.
That's a big glacial fissure. Herald's gonna reset back into the pit. 17 minutes are getting close to elapsing here, and Origin are gonna turn around and be able to pick this one up.
Yeah, but look at G2, they're posturing for a team fight here, which is not what they want to do with the Zed at this point in the game, but kind of stuck.
Problem for G2 is there's no real play to make where Origin won't have a response. Like,
oh,
blocking all the damage of the ulti there.
Just
you are amazing.
Now. Amazing.
Yeah. Yep. Didn't goes up by him, but again, that's the problem for G2 is there's no aggressive play to make that OG can't respond to, either by taking a tower on the other side or being ready with a counter gank. The teleports are soon ready.
They're trying, though.
Kick is trying all into tower.
Oh, there's the tomb. He does manage to get most of his health back with the chrono break, and he turns for Pekka now, but he does not want to fight that fed Lissandra. Mythi coming down in hot pursuit. He'll back off and Kickus gets away.
And right away, Origin is on top side now, pushing in on this tower. It's a good play from Kickus.
Again, he's playing
well. He's being very annoying on this Echo, and it's kind of been G2's only way to really get anything. Both look at kills, but also him getting a bot lane tower. The Zed, you can't really move him anywhere, because if you move him top, well, Pekka's gonna go up there with an hourglass and say, I'm not gonna kill you. We're just gonna sit and hit each other, and there's always the threat of my jungler or me TPing to the other side of the map and taking a team fight.
Yeah, and just insta-locking Zed Blind. We talk about how it's bad in this particular matchup, but if there's one player that you kind of don't want to do that again, looking at the history of League of Legends, it is kind of expected because he used to be a phenomenal Zed player overall too, so he kind of knows all the weaknesses of the champion too, the early gank timers, because they haven't changed over the years. Back in Season 3, you could shut down a Zed early. Season 4, you could shut down a Zed early. Spekka knows this. Mazi's been around for a while, and they gave Perks the textbook answer to an overzealous Zed pick.
Yeah. Yeah. And if you're Origin now, you split up into 1-3-1 as well. You have TPs ready. Peck in one lane, Source in the opposite. Put Sven on wave clear duty in the mid lane. The joy of every AD carry. Sit there and push, push, push. And then you just start basically holding hands as a team, and you move all three lanes up at the same time. And if anyone goes for a gank on any of your members, you should be able to respond. Because you have double TP, and you have to push in the lane. They're actually letting Kickers right now just push on bottom side, because it's an inhib tower he's going for.
Yeah, they're just looking for a force dive here in the mid lane. Peggy on the flank, left side, looks for Ice Claw come out.
This is going to be the tower started here. Trick trying to zone them off. They still got a few more mini waves. That tower's already down to half health, and they knock Trick back in and pop him on up. Can they take him out? Yes, they can. Before he can even get the Lamb's Respite on. That is a quick one for Origin, and the slow moving kick is coming up to the top. He's trying to keep it alive, but Peke puts Emperor in the frozen tomb, and he gets an unstoppable kill. Perks around the backside, does not have the damage to snipe out Sven. And Kickass just comes way too late to do a damn thing. Two kills for Origin. They stay in the middle, they stay on Kickass, and they get him down to half health. They just keep on pushing and chugging away. 20 minutes on the clock, and this is getting pretty big for OG.
Origin just focused on two lanes because they were so confident they could just force a dive and go straight in. Peke
pops his Zhonya's Hourglass. Kickass waits to shut him down. It's Perks who finally picks up the kill. Amazing, chased out by Kickass. Can they get the last shot? No, because Soaz threw his considerable weight in the line of fire.
OG went for the jackpot here, saying we can dive mid. We can just take this big team fight, pick up multiple kills, and then take tower. But it did give G2 a chance to respond, because they couldn't do anything against the 1-3-1. But in a team fight, while this is a great start from Origin, it gives, again, G2 a chance. Not a big one, but a chance at least.
Ooh, Emperor kind of 90 caliber's net straight into the corner here, the late path.
Perks nearly got spent on that one. It was real close, but
yeah, I feel like Emperor should be able to avoid the frozen tomb there, though. If you use both flash and 90 caliber, you still get in range of an ice car. I think you made a mistake here, so he's making a good job at finding an opening, but we're seeing some mistakes creep into the play of G2 here.
I just don't think you had to all in mid here. Again, I think you could just play with double TP on side lanes, but again, G2 or Origin felt like they could go for that one play. They could dive in and get the kill.
Ready, right back to the action.
They got two kills at first, so it looked fine. They're still back with this mid tower because it's so low now.
Yeah, Perks is also quite low. He can't really stick around and keep the fight going. A lot of damage being dealt and a lot of minions being slain. Back and forth, Hurricane procs and everything just keep on flying. Sven trying to clear away Caitlyn traps, but they get placed down just as quickly here. Slow war of attrition, or maybe not so slow. We're just only 21 minutes into this one, and Kickass just keeps trying to chase them down, but keeps getting pushed back and stunned up.
He just has to make sure they don't get baited by this tower here, because it is very low, and it's just a few hits from Origin and dies, and then a full-on team fight with no tower. So I like also Origin playing a bit safer, pushing in on top side, using the teleport. And they know, again, if someone steps away from this mid tower, Sven will take it down.
I mean, I wonder if there's any value in Perks just trading his ulti for Expecus at this point. In terms of team fight,
I think Peke was just Hourglass.
Yep, and there was the ulti.
Worst case for Peke, if he's the man engaging and locking down Emperor, he just Hourglasses himself.
Yep, that's the tower, and they managed to get a knock up onto Hybrid now, so they will get away. They didn't want to chase the kills after the fact, but Trick does indeed want to do that himself, and now Perks just comes out of the woodwork. They start chasing him down, but the barrel disengage will mean they have to back off of that one. Peke still pushing the waves in relentlessly up to the top side. Origin just keeping this slow burn.
Yeah, I think slowing down here though, because Origin is neglecting kind of the setup in this place. Playing a 4-1, not really a 1-3-1. Going for an early cash out instead of just playing the long con. Putting pressure in all three lanes at once. It is a little risky when you play against some heavy assassins that you can get lost in those rotations and kind of get caught off guard. But it's still the preferred play I mean, you're playing with two teleports versus one. Why not lean on that? You know, why not leverage that to your advantage? It is understandable. Teams feel more comfortable in making the map small, especially when they have a lead, because they feel they can just rely on doing improper play with a lead. It kind of makes it okay again.
And again, just Origin saying, we can dive mid here. If they try and defend you, dive, we take the team fight. Ideally, we get two kills or three kills. We take tower then.
Yeah.
And we suddenly got everything.
I mean, Keegan's becoming a menace, though. He gets like a Q assessor at one point. He can really dive into the enemy backline, because look, if you look at Origin, if Keegan is jumping on Sven, he's gonna just be tanking a lot of the peel that is magic damage. If Sven has to run for his life, he can't really return that much damage. Maybe just wreak havoc, you know, stack MR, just be a nuisance.
Oh, I think Trick
accidentally
managed to take away.
I think it's almost better on Trick at this point.
We're seeing mistakes out of both sides here, and this has been a little bit of a wonky game as a result of it. Origin, they're hanging on for dear life. They cannot afford to lose this game, or the Spring Split title's gone.
I mean, I think we've seen a game where a lot of the plays actually were the correct play, especially in the early game when it came to ganking the mid lane a lot and then setting up the dives top with your Origin. So they had some very good plays. It was just obviously just the last few minutes where everything has slowed down a little bit because it didn't invest into the 1-3-1 and opted in for that fight. But at the same time, that fight was so close to just being two kills for Origin and a tower, and it would have been great.
Over. Yeah.
And then it would have been basically game over. So can't really fault them for the decision they made.
I don't think any of these teams is making, aside from maybe the deadlock in pick and ban, any crazy mistake when it comes to the rationale behind their plays. It's just the difference between, you know, one extra skill shot landing or not can be another 5 minutes of the game or just straight game over.
Balancing on a knife's edge here. It's 8:25. This one, the tides have started to turn. So as backs away.
I just love that music. When everything is serious and you're playing for like a championship title, Global Gragas, they'll play your song.
As G2 keep pressure on this top side, Origin keep trying to get the vision around the Baron as well. And teams, I have a feeling they're going to start playing a little bit more towards him. But it is going to be no early starts this game. That should be a bit of a difference, unless G2 just find a huge opening that Origin have not been leaving.
I mean, step one for Origin is always push the two lanes around Baron and then get into the enemy jungle and actually place up some of these deep wards we always see. And then you have the river control by just leaving two or three pings, as we can see one at Baron, one in the bush right next to the mid lane where Sven is right now.
Mm-hmm. And then the anti-TP pink, they've placed there too.
And you just wait out these blue trinkets, and at some point G2 will have to move in and try and place a ward over the Baron and then double TP in behind with Gragas and Syndra, and a teamfight is on. So this trade 1v1 doesn't really matter anything. It's just Source pushing up the wave, and he wants to try and stop Kikis from clearing it out. And then, again, you just get these deep wards in around the enemy red buff. You wait for him to invade in to stop that potential Baron, and then you get your teamfight against the Zed.
Adaptation from Origin, though.
I
like this. For rotation in the bot lane.
Yep.
Wanted to shut down the one teleport that G2 have.
I really like this Morrigan because you know that Zed cannot join. As long as Zed cannot kill the Syndra, this is good for Origin.
It's not happening right now. Peke just realized he can take it. He's going to turn for perks, and that pops the Maw Malmortius. Peke, though, does take a heaping helping of damage on the back mid. Meanwhile, Trick takes out Mithy.
G2
down in the bottom side. Get a double kill for the Kindred.
Man, so the idea was actually smart from Origin. Peke tried to even back away top, saying, okay, guys, go all in, bot lane, I will TP down, and we have a 4v5. But the calling then from G2 is, okay, they're gonna make this TP play. Perks, you have to all in, Delisandre. You have to just all in, so she cannot TP away. So he follows, takes the all in, keeps Peke in lane, and then the rest of Origin was expecting Delisandre to join. Suddenly, it's a 4v4, and G2 catches them out. It's a really smart shot calling, honestly, from both teams.
All right, but what can they do with this right now? Mithy's already going to be back up. We'll take a look at how this happens.
Like, at this point, they're like, oh, we're just going to chase for one kill, and then we always have TP.
I mean, look, no. Amazing right now.
Oh, he's just staying on blue.
That this play is free. So, in Origin's mind, they're making a rotation that G2 can't defend, and they thought that Kikis was just buying time, but they did not expect, I think, all these members to walk through the lane outside of vision, because we had some really decent, like, deep vision from Origin, but they did not have the lane warded. So while Amazing was doing blue buffs, he got completely caught by surprise.
And that was the thing, right? Origin did not expect G2 to all in for a fight, because then TP would happen from Lissandra and the fight would be over. So they're like, okay, it's only one guy buying time, we're not gonna go down there.
Yeah.
But obviously G2 is making the call, like, keep Lissandra busy with fighting top perks, take the 4v4.
And they're closing the gold gap, or keeping it the same distance while the average gold in the game increases. So the relative impact of a 3k gold lead, 2k gold lead, is going
go down right now, it doesn't really mean that much. We have to look, obviously, at compositions, but...
Pekka is strong. Three items now. Again, get these deep wards from Origin. Set up that double TP play in the jungle when G2 is coming in to try and ward off the Baron.
Yeah, any action. Hang on, G2.
Yeah, in comes the Braum. Mithy trying to defend all this one, but G2 had pulled the trigger, and once again, they do not release. Origin on the retreat path, but Mithy takes the Deathmark proc, has to burn his flash. He will stay alive for now. Perks in the front line, taking a little bit low, but Kick is trying to cut them off from the backside. Pekka, he is just caught, puts the tomb on himself for the moment, but the Monsoon will keep G2 healthy for just a few more seconds, and Pekka is slain as the rest of the team amps crates.
Yeah, Soas just arrived into that fight because he was stuck in the bottom lane with no teleport, so he walked over. I feel, unless he teleported into a bad ward.
No, he canceled a teleport.
Okay, because he was stuck on the bottom lane.
Right, exactly. And the fighter already moved away from where he was TPing too. So he cancels it, walks all the way up, and then Pekka in the end. Buys time, but obviously no follow-up.
They flash right on forward, though. Amazing. He's going to go right into the Baron pit to just try and get away from
it. That's the second time we've seen Trick go for an aggressive flash that didn't really pan out. But he also started that engage by being super aggressive. Perks then uses ultimate on Mithy, basically using Mithy as a vessel to get deeper into the team fight. Buying time, and Kikas came in with the winning flank. For me, Kikas has been the reason that G2 isn't dead in the water yet in this game. He's been fantastic at stalling the game, whether it's through split push or some duels. Let's see what happens here. TP.
The rest of the team has already ran away here because Sven is so low. So the call from Origin is to disengage, cancel teleport, and then it's just a chase where in the end, Pekka has no flash to get over the wall and will end up just trying to buy time, really. See Soas at the minimap now, just around mid-tower.
We can see the value from this Susanoo, about how much time she can buy in these fights.
Yeah, I mean, not for that, it might have been a lot worse for Origin on that one. In G2, they hesitated, but now they once again turn their attention there inside.
They built themselves a wall.
Wall of Caitlyn traps. Let's see if it buys them enough to make their team fights great again. 2,500, 1,800, 1,700. This is going to be a spike fight. Who's it going to go to? It's picked Emperor. Up by the Caitlyn. Emperor grabs it. We've seen that one happen before, but on this side, it's a bit different. Now G2 need to beat the retreat. Can they get away? They've lost the trick, but do they lose this fight? Kick is slowed down. Can he get back to base? He's going to dash away, but stunned up by the Braum. Turns back in. Two members down, but G2 secure Baron.
Such an insane Baron play by G2 with everyone alive from Origin against Alessandra as well in that Baron pit.
That was like a 20-80 positive outcome, because even when they get to Baron, they still end up losing because they're 3 against 5 right now on the side of G2. Getting more cupcakes coming out, but very well be one tower going down here.
You eat some very weird cupcakes, Prepper.
Some Zed zoning. This is a little bit strange for sure. The inhibitor tower is going to get fired down. It took them a little while to do it. They just kept getting harassed by the Janna, the Zed, but they do manage to get that tower and get out.
It's the only way to lose weight, man. Cupcakes that bite your tongue. You only eat them once. Suddenly those delicious cupcakes are omitted from your diet.
That's definitely one way to do it.
I'm sad we missed the start of the Baron play because of the replay we
that's
had
before.
That's
it, yeah.
Yeah, but even the setup where G2 felt like they could go for it because all of Origin is around now. And like, it is so lucky that Emperor gets it with an auto attack. In the end.
Calculated.
They still lose two. Lose mid tower as well.
Yep. They do get the dragon though, as you can see on the bottom of your screen. G2 still managing to nab objectives here and there. They just are not able to straight up 5v5 fight out this Origin squad who are hellbent on staying alive here.
And late game, like for G2, it's so much about Emperor on this Caitlyn. What can he do? And of course, Kick is sitting in the back line. Perks right now is just trying to draw attention. Really, in these fights, he's...
I mean, right now.
Always.
Well, Perks has been very slowly creeping and crawling back into this one. 2-3-0, I mean, he had such a rough laning phase. He's still able to get a little bit done, picking up a few spare kills. This is going to be maybe not a tower yet. Pekka's still threatening, but look at Perks around the side, just trying to be a deadly force. Going to get stopped up for just a second by Soas. This tower just keeps taking heavy fire. But Trick, he had the tomb on him. He's managing to put the Lamb's Respite out. This will be enough for the heal. The Janna Monsoon as well. It's like they can just reset these fights again.
They're still very low, Pirate. Trick is almost down at this point. Had early QSS. Call early with 32 minutes and had a QSS. Used it and popped his own ulti, but they're still pushing.
Though. I think I teleported in from Kikis. Now Pekka is going to have to Glacial Path his way away as Mithy stepped in front to block the ace in the hole. This might be an inhibitor tower. Trick on the bottom side. G2 are pressuring this.
Kikis just ulti back though. He walked in to try and zone OG off the tower and just allow the Caitlyn to start hitting this turret. Instead, everything seems to reset. G2 gets another tower, and it is so even in gold.
Yeah, and that value from the Frozen Tomb obviously is going a little bit downwards in the later stages of the fight when it comes to bursting down single targets. So it's at this point of the game that Xpeke will be exclusively self-casting it. Pretty much go in, self-cast, get out, W Zonias, buy time while they try to tear to the front line. But with Janna to reset these fights, or Kigis' ultimate to get back out of the fights, OG can't really focus down a frontliner that easily.
And we talked earlier about how Origin wanted to buy enough time to make the Zed useless in fights. Well, obviously, if we go even later, then the Caitlyn becomes extremely strong. Kindred as well will be able to save, together with the Janna, keep Emperor alive in these fights, unless Source can get a beautiful ulti to knock him out of it, single out that one guy. Has the QSS as well for that flash body slam that will happen.
Yeah, he's not the only one. I mean, three QSSs on the side of G2, they're really respecting the hell out of it now if it didn't kill him before.
Yeah, three Mercs, three QSSs, a Mikael's being built. So this Cocoon, the Sandra combination, definitely losing some value later in the game.
Yep.
But it's done its job. Like, if you look at the early
this game, should have been over by now. Before it closed out beautifully.
Origin has not really been able to commit to 1-3-1. And whenever they did, it was either a little bit too late, or G2 had an answer ready, which surprised Origin, clearly, if you look at that bot lane fight that happened.
Yep.
And at this point, you need to really watch out on team fights for some of the backline members from Origin looking too high on their screen and kind of walking on a trap by accident, because that gives Emperor access to just a free headshot on maximum range, which is incredibly big overall. And if that crits, it can change the tide of the entire fight, because then it can be an opening for Perks to shadow in and finish somebody off.
He's gonna try it. He already went ahead and popped the ghost play, but Kikis on the top side looking to chase down Pekka. He's dealing
so
a whole lot of damage. He cut him off. That's a teleport. Can he get him down in time? It doesn't look like it. No, but Pekka, safe under inner tower, has to back now.
And that's a TP down, so suddenly the flank is not as scary from Origin. So us also TP'd in.
There's no TPs left. For a little while, anyways.
And what looked like a guaranteed game five.
Not so sure.
Slowly turning around to maybe getting closer to championship point for G2 Esports.
Definitely shown incredible tenacity. Their first split in the EU LCS. This is some incredible play to come back right into this one after a very bloody and rough start.
And now Kigis will have teleport before the two guys on the side of Origin. So he can go bot lane, push it out, start setting up for Baron if you are G2. Try and bait Origin into a bad fight where they don't have full vision of what is going on, and just protect this Caitlyn here as much as possible. Perks is not going to dive for Lissandra. He can't really dive straight onto Sven. He can deal damage to him, but he won't be able to kill him. Might do that just to get by time. Just get Sven out of the fight, because he's the consistent DPS on the side of Origin. Pekka will go in, ulti himself, then outlast himself, so he needs the AD carry next to him, dealing damage while he's buying time. If Perks is able to sacrifice himself just to stop Sven from doing it, it's a win for G2.
Might indeed be, but it would be the longest. We've already passed 36 minutes. It's the longest game of this series. We know G2 like to play it fast and loose, and it might be once again inner tower going a little bit low. So I was trying to flank around the side, but Kikis has his number. The rest of Origin are going to be able to clear out the wave, though, so no harm done here. Emperor steps forward. He's caught on a cocoon, but there is a quick QSS. Burns the flash and the net. Everything to get away from this one.
That's Origin overstepping here.
They might just push for it, looking for Kikis. He's racing
flash,
out of the jungle, though.
Flash being down is huge for Origin here. You can body slam flash now as Soas straight onto Emperor. Knock him into your own team, and then suddenly he's down.
It changes the entire approach to the team fight, really, because that...
such a big mistake, because Barons are alive now. The whole setup for G2 was push up top, set up Baron vision, and be ready to fight around it. Now suddenly Origin have the Baron control despite having no teleports.
Emperor can still play aggressively though if Hybrid just hovers right next to him and resets the Gragas if he goes for that play here. Immediate start on the Baron though for Origin.
Yeah, let's see if G2 can do anything about this one. Teleport has started to channel on the bottom side. We might be in for another smite fight. In goes Perk.
Trick is taken!
Trick is a god! I cannot believe it! And now Origin are just going to fall back and forth. Emperor slain by Pekka, however, so the fight may not be said and done. Amazing Will gets splatted on the back of that one, but so has double team on. Not before Perks is able to come up with another pickup on his Sven. A 3-for-3 Baron to G2. Excuse me, 3-for-2. I got ahead of myself.
A lot of people jumping around left, right, and center. Baron's dying, and Trick, another hero steal.
keeping G2 Esports in the game. Kikas was trapped in that Baron Pit. Three members from Origin had a quick glimpse of it. It's like, you know what? I think we're done here.
Yeah, Kikas now just trying to zone out as SOAS. I can't believe this is just happening the way it is. G2 pick up a gold lead here. Still chasing down Peke, who has summoners back, but he burns. No flash.
That was very close.
Yeah, very, very. And meanwhile, Perks is on the top side, just punishing this tower.
Kikas just buying time by chasing, stopping Peke from ever recalling. Perks has to run back now as well. But another situation where G2 are making a mistake, which then means Origin suddenly has a chance to actually take Baron and get more kills. But then they manage to get the Baron in another 50-50.
Yeah, Trick here really buying so much time for his team. And Origin is quartered in the top left part of the pitch, which gives a lot of access to our AoE. Then Hybrid kind of splits the fight up, gets the exhaust to Sven. He's just buying time here. Look at how close it becomes for Twig here at the right end of the fight between Expecta. One more hit and he can get Expecta down, but a good zone here has kind of prevented that. It also shows you just how much damage Kikas does when he's left untouched.
Talk about beating the odds. Meanwhile, the gold has slowly slipped to the red side. G2 now pushing on this dragon will be their number two. Be a very long game if we end up seeing five dragons in this one, but it has been so back and forth, and finally Peter Totter swinging G2's way.
Still helps late game getting that burn on the towers. Now TP coming in from Origin.
And that is a fast SOAS around the side. Peke though, he gets the Zhonya's on and will deny the death mark. No! Oh! He just misplayed it! And that is gonna change everything! Now G2 on the chase with the Baron empowered minions. Mythi, Sven, amazing SOAS running as fast as they can back into base. There's still half a minute on Baron.
I can't believe Peke just died.
Alright, Demon.
We just died,
don't
believe.
It's gonna be a tower.
I wasn't robbing. That's all good. I was playing.
That's gonna be inhibitor turret. That's gonna be inhibitor. That's definitely gonna be Mythi. Perks is dominating after an atrocious laning phase. He's 63. This is absolute insanity.
Yeah, that's half a second mistake that may cost them the game. Shadow Mark is 3 seconds. Zhonya has 2.5.
The monster.
Peke with the rookie mistake here. Origin under pressure.
Such a tense moment here. Origin trying to hang firm. Deathmark already back up. They turn their attention to Sven. Perks going way too low. Oh, Perks! He's gonna grab another kill. It's amazing. And SOAS, that's the last Nexus turret. That's gonna be it. We have a new king in Europe after all. 2015, they proved they were LCS material. 2016, they're top of the charts. We thought it was going to be five games, but G2 had other plans. And 2 seconds, 1 second, half a second.
I'm so impressed with the way they're handling this game. Everything looked so poorly for their mid laner, the star player, going down so many times, and yet they keep it cool. Great shot calling, great reactions from this team. Get two Barons as well. And then in the end.
I mean, Kikas bought them so much time. We have
Kikas had a sick game.
Because if you look at the start of the season, he sometimes was doing, tank player only, low impact, but he bought so much time with that Echo pick overall.
It is no longer a bad thing to be a tank player.
That's a good thing right now.
You are a top laner.
Definitely worked wonders for them, and there are so few words to describe how G2 hung in there.
God, how horrible this must feel for Origin, because they were at the brink of turning it all around.
But at the end of the day,
that's a dream. That's a dream for any player in Europe to be able to lift that trophy. Has to be absolutely fantastic here for G2 Esports.
They earned every accolade we had.
Challenger team coming into the LCS. Pick up two new players and move your jungler to the top lane. Get a new coach in Youngbuck. And they deserve this so much.
Every step of the way. They proved that they were the best team EU had off.
This team was number one almost every single week. They come into playoffs, We're like, okay, what can they do in a BO5? Well, they start taking down first Fnatic, 3-1. Going to the final. Take on Origin and another 3-1 by this team. Even some of the games where we're like, oh, this is really hard now for them.
Yep.
They managed to pull it out. And Perks in the end here ended up with 7 kills on this Zeph. He was down 0-3.
And he comes right back into it. I mean, this is, we talked so much about the blind pick turning around, and then, oh, he just, oh, it's fine. It's just going to start picking up kills. Pick is going to buy him time. It's all going to be okay. And what an incredible second, third win just to finish this one off. That was, by the way, the longest game we've had for G2 in quite some time, about 41 minutes. They've lost 5 games over the total of the LCS. They have an average game time lower than everyone else. They just speed ran the LCS.
Yeah, but crushing defeat for Origin at the same time, but I think they can leave with head up, held up high. Well, pretty much, because nobody expected them to even get to the final if we go back like 3 or 4 weeks.
Yeah.
Nobody expected them, honestly, to challenge G2 to this close of a game. Okay, maybe after recent performances, but overall, looking back to the middle of the season, nobody thought they would be in this spot. And honestly, they were very close to making it in game 5, and then anything could happen yet again. So it was oh so close.
Oh, yeah. This was such a huge, huge expectation on them after we started seeing them win. But before it, no one saw this G2 team coming. And, you know, Origin, they were the heir apparent. And it came all down to it at the end of the day. The new kids on the block showed up.
Big stuff for Ocelot as well. Creating a G2 was actually a step behind Pekka. You know, he made Origin, top 4 Worlds.
Several years before he could make LCS.
I mean, he kept trying. And people, people made fun of him. Like, he tried to get on the LCS with you on the roster. Okay, it didn't work. But, I mean, persistence paid off.
Yeah.
Did some really solid choices with picking up Emperor.
Great scout.
And honestly, like, he had the MVP of the split in his team.
Yep.
Some rookies to build on Hybrid and Perks overall with some solid performances. A solid team.
Kept the strong core again, moved Kickers to the top lane, proved to be a good choice.
It was absolutely proved correct, and Kickers was like, I can lane swap, it's no problem. Yeah. Well, apparently he can.
I'm a little afraid for MSI for some of these matchups, but that's maybe just too early.
But it's going to be exciting no matter what.
I think this is a great team we can send to MSI, because I think you need to sometimes go in and try and match some of the aggressiveness we are expecting to see from LMS. If Rocks Tigers goes from Korea, see G2 try and match it. And also learn from it. Because, again, it's a young team. I think this team will gain a lot from going to MSI.
Absolutely. Well, with all said and done, though, and the new victors, we're going to send it to Pulse on stage to talk to the 2016 Spring Champions.
Thank you so much, guys. I'm here with two of the champions right here. And crowd favorites, I think, gentlemen. First off, I've got to talk to you, Hybrid, about the end of that game, because that was absolutely nutty as you got to the end of that one. And you guys turned it around through team fights in the very ending of that game. What was the emotion like on the team?
I mean, we were behind, like, pretty far. But everyone knew that we would win the game because our team plan was better, I think. And the Sun was pretty strong, but I have exhaust for every fight. But everyone is so happy right now, you know, that we won. And everyone kept being positive. So, yeah, we won the game because of it.
That's awesome to hear. And Youngbuck as well, sitting behind the scenes, how was it for you watching your team just go ham on the stage today?
Well, I was very scared because the entire split I've been saying that I don't like Zed into Lissandra. And when Amazing helped him a lot, I thought we had a lot of trouble. But the team was consistently reassuring each other that the longer the game goes on, the more chance they have to win. So, and when they got a few team fights off and started winning, I was like, okay, they got this.
This is it. And also, I want to talk about stylistically, your team is very fast. Like, compared to yesterday, these games were extremely quick. And is this what you've been teaching those guys, or have you tried to mold the team around what they have individually as players?
I think I'm very lucky that my players are able to play pretty much every champion, and that they know a lot about the game. I'm just there for them to tell me what they think about the game, and I just move it to the next person.
Well, you've done very well with the team. Congratulations, Youngbuck. And finally here, Hybrid, is there anything you want to say to your fans here in the Ahoy Arena?
Thanks, everyone, for coming. It means a lot for me. It's my first split, and I immediately won the LCS. So I'm really happy, and thanks, everyone, for coming.
I want to extend that as well to you, Youngbuck. In a second. Youngbuck, anything you want to say to the guys here in the arena?
Ja, ik wil iedereen graag bedanken voor jullie komst en
Well, thank you so much, guys, and taking the time to talk to me. Congratulations. We're going to send it back over to the analyst desk.
Thank you so much, Pulse and Hybrid and Young Buck. Just saying he wants to thank everyone for coming there in Dutch. Right at the end, you got to do that. Well, first off, to round things out, I think we have a very, very nice champion here. And I love the fact that we talked about history in the beginning of the series. And this is a new guard. This is a totally new team. And I think it's a great feat what they've done probably throughout the entire season, coming in from Challenger, from Zero, and now winning this whole thing.
Yeah, I actually really like they didn't really sway from their style at all. Like, you know, we were up here on the desk like saying, like, oh, this is a good pick and this is a bad pick. And they kept just doing what they liked. And it honestly ended up working out because they're making all these, like, you know, fights that are really hard to predict. And it's kind of like baits the enemy to make mistakes and, like, punishes it really hard.
Yeah, just a quick note, we will be going through some more interviews with the winners in a sec, but we can talk about the series and maybe the last game as well. You guys were giggling a little bit when they said, oh, well, we had a good draft, but then the Lissandra versus Zed discussion came up as well. Febby, what did you make of it?
I think the Gamers 2 really got outdrafted here. Like, the Zed pick was, I think, really terrible picking into that. It was like 0-3, and I think OG could have won the game if they played it out solid, but Trick managed to steal two Nashors, oh, and we know that OG is not good at closing out games. We saw it through the hills, the whole playoffs, and even in scrims they are not good at it. And yeah, they just won fights and then.
Yeah, and then it all goes wrong at the Barons as well. I mean, yeah. Amazing played pretty well this game as well, and to be honest, the series, but on the Elise, we were talking, just ran out of options. The Cocoons just couldn't quite find the right targets later on, and it slows Origin down, and G2 capitalized, rightly so, from some good fights.
Yeah, I mean, Amazing also had a great series, but in the end, Trick is incredibly consistent throughout all of that, and then those things are just those little touches of magic, of extra that you need, those steals as well. You guys are talking a lot about perks, obviously. You're saying how he can win you the game, but he can completely throw it to you as well. What do you make of his performance overall?
I don't know, man. He's it's up to, he wants to make sure he's the one that, like, is the one typing FF for everyone else, or he's the one typing it for the enemy team. Like, he makes sure, like, I'm gonna make this or break this game. And he kind of didn't calm down ever. Like, he's like 0-2, still using like W in lane aggressively.
Yeah, you just see how aggressive he plays, and even when he's 0-2, like he says, he's still playing aggressive, and yeah, he's really trying to carry, and it's good to see, because he's, the way he plays, it's really good a way to improve fast.
Well, I'm gonna cut you off right there, because I think we have the man himself standing by with Pulse.
Thank you so much, guys. I'm here with two more players from G2. I just had to speak to a couple more, and I actually want to follow that point from Fevin. You're super aggressive, and you were even more aggressive in this series, even in front of all these people here. So was that just a mentality coming into the one? You just want all-out aggression perks?
Well, you really, to make plays, you need to be aggressive. To put pressure, you need to be aggressive. So being aggressive as much as possible is always good. But then it kind of backfired a bit game four, because of the Sandra-Elise combo. But yeah, I was really confident going into the series.
Very competent, but you were also against an exceptionally strong mid lane in two different mid lane as well. We heard earlier today in the feature that we had that you didn't really care who it was, so did that play out in the game's perks?
I think they need more than two mid laners to defeat us. I'm kidding. I think they're both really good, and the game four, Pekka actually really out-pressured me hard. Like, he made so many plays with Lissandra, they were like so far ahead, I don't even know how did we win. But yeah, I'm just happy that we won. I don't know.
Yeah, and it was a super entertaining series as well, Perks. Over to you, Kickers. Just going along the theme of just hyper-aggression, you guys were super aggressive, especially in game one. You just came out of the gate swinging, but then OG kind of slowed you down. So what kind of happened in the series that you stopped being as fast as the first game?
Well, like, going into the games, we knew we were going to have four red sides. So we had, like, mostly, like, one plan of the draft going into the games. And after it worked, okay, we were like, the second game, the bans were the same, and they managed to, like, shape it up a bit and, like, catch us off guard, I guess. But, like, we managed to come back, like, no one was, like, afraid or scared that we lost one game, and we just kept going.
Okay, final one here, Kickers, as well. You didn't manage to win the Spring Championship last year, then you joined Challenger, and now you're here in the Ahoy Arena and managed to take it. What does that mean to you on that journey?
Honestly, it just means a lot. It means everything, because last year, like, I was only, like, on the side looking at, like, Fnatic getting the trophy and having the trophy in my hands and having the feel of winning and us having the opportunity to go to MSI and face international teams. It's just great, and I'm really happy for it.
Well, thank you so much, gentlemen, for the time you've given me, and congratulations on the win. We're going to send it back over to the LSS to close out the day.
Oh, they need more than two mid laners to beat us. Oh, classic perks right there. Want to touch on what just Kiki's his emotion. I can totally understand that. What great from him, and he had a fantastic series overall. And throughout the split, there have been a lot of doubts about him, but especially the last game, he stepped up.
There have been, and you know, there is something to be said about individual performance, but then the meta fitting you and you are able to excel, and we're like, oh, he does play Echo, he can play these champions that maybe we didn't quite expect at first, but it's been a very successful move up to the top lane for him. So impressive to see how he came through Challenger, as Pulse was talking about, now into his first split on G2 in the LCS, and they win it.
Yeah, fantastic. And another individual performance that was really, really good in today's series. Trick left it all on the Rift and in the Baron Pits with the title and a ticket to MSI on the line. Absolutely stepping up. 14 kills, 22 assists, and a whole lot of Baron steals in four games. He is our series MVP. And, you know, Perks had some really flashy moments indeed, and he said it himself there that they came back. But Trick was just incredibly consistent and proving once again why he is the MVP of the split. A great player.
Yeah, even like... And throughout the series, like even when he was like ganking bot lane, when bot lane's behind and stuff, he was trading his flash for like flash and heal and stuff. Like he was doing like really efficient plays that was actually like, getting parts of the map ahead that were kind of behind. And normally you want to play on your strong side, but they kind of, you know, said screw that and just play the way that they like, which is, you know, always playing around bot lane. So I'm glad that he didn't really get scared when things took a change, because their bot lane is pretty strong. But this whole series, I think, Niels and Mithy like outplayed them really hard in lane. So it was really good that they're just like, hey, like, let's just keep laning in 2v2 and we'll bring Trick down here and do something with it.
Yeah, fantastic, fantastic performance by them. Well, we are here in the Netherlands in Rotterdam yesterday. Fnatic manages to win it all with Fevin on their team. Now we have Youngbuck and Hybrid there for G2 winning it all. What is in the air here, Fevin?
Yeah, I'm a bit jelly, actually.
Yeah. You could have lifted the trophy there, but yeah.
Not too bad.
Oh, no, you're not. The guys love you here. But we have a beautiful champion. And in addition to the Spring Championship for them, G2 Esports has taken a big step on the road to Worlds by banking 90 championship points. And I give 70 to Origin as well. What do we make of Origin's performance here? Better than expected if you look at the split.
Yeah.
But they were close.
Especially when you look at Origin midway through the split, we were like, okay, they're sat in sixth. We don't expect too much from them. IEM was rocky for them as well. They go away, still came back looking a bit rough and suddenly found their form in playoffs. And it was good to see them find some of the form we saw from them last year. I still think they've got a long way to improve, and hopefully we'll see an even stronger Origin in summer.
You said we're just going to try and win the whole thing and go to Worlds straight. What do you think of the rest of the competition in the summer split of EULCS? It's looking to be very exciting, very tight for those top three spots.
Yeah, the competition is already really tough right now. Going into summer split, it's going to be even harder. Like, I think even Origin is not even far away from G2. Like, I think this series was really close. They should have won the last game, and then we would have had five games. And then the last game can go anywhere, too. So it's like really close, all the teams.
Yeah. Yeah. I agree. I mean, it's going to be summer split, so everyone's going to have the same mentality going in. It's going to be a bigger chunk of the pie towards Worlds. So I think everyone stepping up is going to get contagious with everyone tryharding a lot more. So I kind of just expect every team to step up a couple notches. And I think it's going to be like, I don't know, it's going to be a really, really like tight ship to get to the very top.
Yeah, I think it is. I mean, the thing I'm interested in is how is G2's momentum going to keep going? They just got MVP, rookie coach, and the win of the split now. So there's not much more to pick up apart from maybe a perfect record for Bivin. Maybe they're hot on your heels on that one for summer. Too early to tell, I think.
We will see. We do know that the guys over in Las Vegas are getting set up for TSM versus CLG. One thing that we got to talk about quickly, though, is G2 Esports at MSI as the European representative. Although we saw really good things from him, I know you guys had a thing or two to say about some of the performances maybe. How do we think they can do overall, Febby?
I think they really have a shot at like really fighting the teams because they're really aggressive and they really team fight really good. But if they draft like they did today, I think they're just going to get outclassed in the ban and pick phase, because You're not going to get away with this kind of comps against the better comps, and people are not going to make silly mistakes and not get snowballed on, and I just think that's going to be the difference.
Yeah, I agree with Febby. You know, they picked the Zed into Lissandra, and all it took was, you know, two Elise ganks to make that lane snowball like crazy. You know, so really simple things like, oh, their comp is built with Zed, you shut down Zed, you win the game. I think if they pick these like really one-dimensional comps that need a certain person to get ahead, they'll just focus that guy, and he won't get ahead, and then they'll have like no strength in the comp.
I'm excited to see them up against the likes of what we expect to be the Rocks Tigers coming out from Korea, because you see glimpses of the play style that G2 are trying to adapt at no any of the same level, unfortunately, for our European representative. We'll see if they can level up to that anywhere near that point coming into MSI. But I think it's a good matchup, at least for fans to be excited about.
We'll see if they can do better than a Fnatic, the five games dream versus SKT. It was a very good performance. We're almost ready to go over to TSM versus CLG, but I do want to touch in with you guys because you've been tweeting up a storm all day. And one of those tweets comes from @MergeVerso. He thinks G2 is ready for the international stage and tweeted, they have shown their ability to adapt to the meta and know how to play when ahead and behind. Well, unfortunately, when you throw a game and then have to get it back in your hands, that's also not ideal way.
It's just the same. Yeah. The way they call plays, it's always the same. Like, there's like five missing on the map and they're like, we'll do Baron. Doesn't matter if they're 10k ahead or behind, that's the call that they'll make at that point.
Yeah. Well, while things are said and done here in Europe until the summer split, the 2016 Mid-Season Invitational is just a few weeks away. The top teams from regions around the world will convene in Shanghai, China, the May 4th for a two-week tournament with a lot on the line. And G2 will be joining the LMS's Flash Wolves as the first teams to qualify. Then the question is, of course, who will be the North American representative? If you listen to the crowd, it's TSM, but what do you think?
I go with TSM. It pains me a little. They perform badly in the regular split, but they've got something now.
TSM.
Bjergsen's my boy.
Okay, so we'll see what happens. Well, I'd like to thank you guys for joining us on the desk here in the Netherlands. Fabian, it must have been a great experience for you here.
The crowd is amazing here, and I really want to play in my country again, and it's just something I will never forget in my life.
No, it was amazing here. Nederland, jullie zijn geweldig. Until then, that is all from us here in Europe. Before we send it to Las Vegas, it's Mandalay Bay for the North American LCS Finals. Thank you so much for joining us throughout the 2016 European LCS Spring Split.
It's time to load up onto Summoner's Rift and kick off the 2016 LCS season. He sees him coming, and he should jump.
Fnatic has been top six entire split long. Fnatic has been down to bottom entire season. And that's telling a lot because Fnatic's performance, it hasn't been the greatest.
Public expectations and internal expectations were that Origin could reclaim their former glory. But that's not what we saw.
I don't think the jungle changes are helpful for them. I think they're getting behind with it because they can't really build up synergy.
H2K finish the weekend undefeated. H2K.
I don't think anybody expected G2 to be this strong coming into the split.
G2 Esports are the best team in Europe.
Princess Ray needs his pillow.
Where is my second pillow? I am so triggered. I need my pillow.
Rocket, the Giants, and the Splice Boys re-qualifying for the summer split.
And with the lineups all locked in, it's time to see how these two shake out as we start our best of five series to determine who is going to the semis. Spirit is actually going to walk away, and Combo Shark's going to have to dash. Oh, and look at those health bars! Oh my lord!
We'll see them in Rotterdam, and I cannot wait!
And Origin! Origin will be performing a clean sweep. They keep their hopes of another final alive.
And we are into game. Game one of this best of five with Origin and H2K taking to the rip.
Origin! Origin! Origin!
The Nexus turret is going down, and against all odds, Origin take down H2K and are your first finalists in the Spring Split.
And it's time to see if the new kids on the block can take on the reigning European champions.
Kick back! Oh, Emperor! He's able to get out of this one!
Fnatic with a 1-1 to even the series.
Even though they look good, I think we look much better.
Fnatic melting, the game is over. GG, the Red Hot Rookies will knock off the reigning champs en route to a spring showdown in Rotterdam.
Welcome to the 2016 LCS Spring Finals, coming to you live from the Ahoy in Rotterdam.
Turns and he keeps on. Whoa! Holy moly! They demolish Origin.
Pick.
He's gonna get there in time. He jumps in and he finishes! Oh my goodness! That's the last Nexus turret. That's gonna be it. We have a new king in Europe after all. 2015, they proved they were LCS material. 2016, they're top of the charts.